Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to our worship this morning. Whether you're here in the Gospel Center or down at the Classic Service, up at our Sioux campus, or if you're listening live on the radio, watching on TV, or part of our online campus, we are so glad you're part of worship this morning. I know you've enjoyed our time of worship through singing and the celebration of communion. I want to remind you that those empty communion packets, you'll be able to dispose of as you leave this morning. And because it's Communion Sunday, it's also our tradition that we have elders at the doors as you leave with offering plates. And if you would like to give a special gift to the Elder Fund, that's the fund we use to help people in our church and in our community that come into a crisis situation, you can give to that cash or check made out to the church by putting it in those offering plates as you leave. Every penny put in those plates goes towards our Elder Fund. Now, our regular general fund giving can happen through a couple of ways. If you're here in the auditorium, as you leave this morning, you can put it in one of the boxes that are back by the doors as you exit. Or you can give online by going to our website, myefree.org, and clicking on Give. And that will walk you through a safe and secure process for you to worship God through tithes and offerings. Well, obviously, I'm not here in person this morning because Laura and I are out in Pennsylvania where we're having the joy of welcoming into the world our third grandchild. So we're enjoying our time with our kids and our grandkids. But this morning, it is a privilege for me to be able to introduce our speaker. Steve Habusta is the campus pastor up at our Sault Ste. Marie campus. And he is a man that has very good at communicating the Word of God in very practical ways. So I know you're going to enjoy and benefit from all that Pastor Steve has to share with us right now. So would you please welcome Pastor Steve Habusta as he brings the Word of God.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate it very much. I just want to note that at the Sioux campus, we don't have to tell people to throw away their garbage. I don't know. That might just be our campus. Well, I'm glad to be here with you all from Gaylord here, and I'm thankful to spend this time with you today, whether you're watching here or online, and give a shout out for our Sioux campus. They're a great group, and I miss them when I'm not there. So, yeah, thank you. This month actually marks the fifth year anniversary as Sioux Free Church. And if you asked me to tell you the story of our campus over the last 5 years, I would tell you this. The story is Kingdom Impact. That's what our story is. Now, I could tell you about the exponential growth our campus has experienced. I could tell you that over the five-year course, if Gaylord E-Free were to grow at the same rate, there'd be 2,100 people here today. I could tell you that, but that's not our story. I could tell you all about our amazing staff that we have and the countless hours that they volunteer above and beyond. I could tell you about our volunteers and the way they serve in so many different ministries, especially as a smaller church, so the way that they're serving. I could share with you the story of our building and how we've managed to take a 60-year-old traditional Baptist church and transform it into a building that is welcoming for young people, children, and families where they feel comfortable. I could tell you all those things, but that's not our story. Those things tell a story, but that's not our story. Our story is the story of Kingdom Impact. It's the story of a church committed to serving our community. Not so that we can grow our campus or our church. No, we serve our community so our community can experience the very love of Jesus Christ. No strings attached, no agenda. And in doing so, resulting in Kingdom Impact. It's a story of a campus, of a church that recognized that there was a group of people who were not being reached in our community. And a story of how we became a church that specifically targeted 18 through 35 year olds. And as a result, had Kingdom Impact. It's a story of a church committed to accepting, including, and loving broken and hurting people by going out of our way to connect with them, connect with groups, and connect with people in the margins. resulting in community impact. It's the story of a church committed to reaching the next generation with programming and events that connect with children in a truly authentic manner and resulting, once again, in kingdom impact. See, our story is a story of kingdom impact. And so it's been a great 5 years. And I told the Sioux campus earlier that when I get back, we're having cake because I love to celebrate with cake. And so I just want to say happy birthday, Sioux E-Free. What a run it's been. You know, in 1988, something really weird happened. If you're a person who loves music, if you're a music buff, then you'll know this. Something really weird happened. On the Billboard 100, there was a new number one hit that no one thought would ever make it. In fact, it took Guns N' Roses' Sweet Child of Mine and knocked them off the number one pedestal. And it was an a cappella song. It went a little bit like this. Don't worry. Be happy. You guys know that one? You guys can finish it later on. It's all right. Teach it to your kids, by the way. This idea of don't worry, be happy. Boy, that's easy when things are going good, isn't it? It's so easy not to worry and to be happy when things are going good in our life. When our bank account is a little higher than we anticipated. It's so easy not to worry and be happy when our children are healthy or our parents are healthy. It's so easy not to worry and be happy when we're not stressed and our job situation is awesome. It's easy. But the reality is, it's a whole lot harder not to worry and be happy when things aren't going good. When we're in things like, I don't know, say a global pandemic during a presidential election year. It's not as easy not to worry and be happy when times are not good, when we're struggling financially, when our marriage seems to always be on our rocky soil, when things with our kids aren't good, when our health is at risk, when we're worrying about our safety and our security. It's not, don't worry, be happy. It's manage our stress and our anxiety and our depression. Which is why I wanted to take the next 2 weeks to really listen to how God speaks to us during our anxiety and depression. Now, if our Sioux campus is lucky, because they're going to get to hear part two live. And if you're here at the Gaylor campus and watching online, I would love for you to like our Sioux campus Facebook page. And when Pastor Chad is done speaking next week, I'd love for you to go on there and watch part two as well so you can begin to see how God speaks to our depression. Because today we're going to talk about anxiety. See, I believe this. If I ask for a show of hands of how many of you have anxiety or have gone through situational anxiety or deal with anxiety either on an inconsistent or regular basis, there'd be two groups of people in this room. There would be the group that raises their hand and say, yes, Pastor Steve, I have anxiety. And there'd be another group of people in the room that would have too much anxiety to raise their hands. We all deal with anxiety at different points in our life. But it's even getting worse. Did you know that over 20% of Americans have been diagnosed with an anxiety disorder just over the last 12 months? Google Trends indicate searches for the word anxiety have skyrocketed over the past 5 years. That's even before the pandemic. And let's be honest. Whether we want to admit it or not, the virus, the election, the cultural conditions in our country have led to an increase in anxiety for many of us. I know that's true because I read many of your Facebook pages. In fact, so much so that whenever I meet with somebody in my office for counseling, or so many times when we get prayer requests at the Sioux campus, almost always they have to deal with anxiety. And here's the truth. With so many of us dealing with anxiety, that it's time we come to this realization that COVID-19 hasn't caused our anxiety. No, COVID-19 has revealed our anxiety. It's shown it to us. And it's something we have to deal with. So today I want to look at the spiritual side of anxiety. Now, I want to be really careful here, because I come from a family of medical professionals, and understand this, I think there is a spiritual side of anxiety, and I think there's a clinical side of anxiety. I think oftentimes within the Christian faith, we deal with the spiritual side, and we just hope people make it through the clinical side. I want to say this to you, I'm going to look at the spiritual side today, but if you need help with the clinical side, and you're here at our Gaylor campus, I would love for you to call, get a hold of Jack Dutton. Jack is, I'm not supposed to have favorites, but Jack is my favorite. All right, get a hold of Jack, and he'll walk you through that clinical side. And if you're up at the Sioux campus, I would love for you to call me. We'll set up a time in my office, and we'll go through the clinical side as well as the spiritual side. But today I want to look at the spiritual standpoint of anxiety. And what I want to do is I want to show you a little bit of what I believe anxiety is from a spiritual standpoint. And I want to give you a tool, something that you can take with you, something you can remember to help you deal with that anxiety when it comes up, when it rears its head. I want to give you this tool. So if you have your Bible, open them up to Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. And if you don't have a Bible, I would just encourage you to look, the words will be up here on the screen, but if you don't have an easy-to-read translation of your Bible, we would love to get you one. We would love to make sure you have a Bible. See one of the elders in back on the way out, and they'll get you a Bible. And as I read this story, if you're dealing with anxiety right now, lean into it. Lean into it. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let's go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in a boat, just as he was, and other boats were with him. Jesus has been doing ministry all day, and he gets to the point where he's going to leave the crowd. He's going to go ahead and off, and I think there's a message there for another time about how we sometimes we need to get to the other side of the lake. But as Jesus is going, he's in this boat. People are following him, even in their boats. And then the scripture says this, a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling. See, the lake where Jesus was surrounded by these mountains. And kind of like you all live in this snow bowl here where the snow just seems to circulate and circulate and circulate, kind of like that, in the same way that the storms would come up over the mountains, still to this day, they come up over the mountains, they kind of swirl around over that lake. And people will be out on their boats, and out of nowhere, storms will just appear. It's kind of like our anxiety, isn't it? We'll just be going along, doing our thing, and we'll get a phone call. And all of a sudden, those waters will just start shaking out of nowhere. We'll be going and we'll open a letter in the mail. And all of a sudden, the winds start pushing our boat. Out of nowhere, sometimes our anxiety comes and our anxiety happens. And just like these disciples and sailors, we fail. We respond in much of the same way. The boat's rocking, I'm going to die. The storms around me, I'm going to die. In fact, if you've had an anxiety attack, it feels like you're going to die. Your heart starts doing some weird things. Your breathing starts doing weird things. We feel like we're going to die, and we should, right? I mean, we should be scared. The boat's moving all around. Our bank account's empty. Our marriage is on the rock. All these things are happening. We should be scared, right? Jesus wasn't. See what's going on with Jesus? Let's continue on in our story. Says this, but he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. Some translations say he was asleep with his head on the cushion. Now that's a good sleep. I mean, everybody else is freaking out, worried about this storm. My man, Jesus is comfortable. He's laying there, he's chilling with his head on a cushion. So they woke him, and they said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And see, I find this so interesting. because we don't know much about the specifics of the storm. We know that it was coming into the boat. We know that the waves are coming into the boat, but we don't know how long it's been going on. We don't know how far away from the shore they were. Could they have swam in? We don't know any of that stuff. But we do know a lot about their response. Teacher, don't you care? Teacher, don't you care that the storm is all around us? Teacher, don't you care that I might get sick? Teacher, don't you care that my business is failing? Teacher, don't you care that my marriage is falling apart? Teacher, don't you care that my kids are in trouble? Teacher, don't you care? And I get it. Because that's been my response way, way too much. Scripture goes on and says this, and he, Jesus, awoke, and he rebuked the wind, and he said to the sea, peace, be still. Now, if you ever wondered if Jesus was fully God, this right here is your proof. Because if somebody wakes me when I'm napping like that, I'm not yelling at the storm. I'm yelling at whoever woke me up, right? But not Jesus. Jesus goes and he yells and he calms the storm by saying, peace, be still. And I think that's actually pretty important. Because Jesus doesn't deal with their anxiety. Jesus deals with their problem. Did you catch that? Man, sometimes I just want to feel good, right? So I call out to Jesus hoping that I just might feel better about my situation. Jesus doesn't want me to feel better. He wants me to be in a better situation. And so he speaks to their problem, not to their anxiety. He awoke, rebuked the wind and the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And after the calmness, he settles in and he speaks to them and he says to them, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? They had been with him. They had seen him. They knew exactly what Jesus was, exactly who he was. And yet still have you no faith? And can I say this? Maybe this is the question we need to ask ourselves today. Maybe this is a question we need to ask ourselves when anxiety keeps us up at night. Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? Maybe this is the question we need to ask ourselves when things just keep us from moving forward. Why are you afraid? Do you have no faith? See, if you struggle with anxiety, whether it's situational or otherwise, I want you to take away this key point found in the last verse here. And it says this, and they were terrified. And they said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? See, the key of this whole story is in that word right there, terrified. That's the key to the whole story. You see, at the beginning of the story, these men were scared. They were afraid because there was a storm around them, because the boat was rocking, because water was coming in. They were afraid because of the conditions that they were in. But by the end of this story, these men were more scared. They were terrified. But it wasn't anxiety from the storm. See, I think what anxiety is, anxiety is simply misplaced fear. See, at the end of the story, these men are terrified. The actual Greek translation there is this. They were terrified with the maximum amount of terror. I can't say it any more clearly. They were terrified with the maximum amount of terror, but it wasn't from the storm. It was because of Jesus. See, anxiety is misplaced fear. It's thinking that our storm is bigger than our God. It's focusing on the storm around us rather than focusing on the God inside of us. And you know what? You're right. I don't know how big your storm is. Some of you are going through some really big storms right now in your life. Some of you have just been through storms, and some of you are going to go through some big storms in your life. I don't know how big your storm is. I really don't, but I do know how big our God is. And I do know that no matter what storm you're going through in life, God is bigger than that storm. And it's easy for me to say these words. But it's harder for us to live them. So how do we keep our head above water? We'll find out here in just a minute. How do we do that? How do we focus on God and not the storm around us, keeping our head above water? Well, I want to give you a tool. It comes from scripture in the book of Philippians, and I think it's just a practical tool that we can take with us no matter where we are in life. Scripture says this in Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7, it says this: do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You know, as I was in Virginia, I used to coach at a pool that was just down the street from our house. And so I would get up early and I would go to the practice, and my two boys who swam for me and who were 12 and 10 at the time would come. And it was really nice because the pool was just far enough away where my wife could look out her window and she could watch and she could see the boys just walk to the pool. But there's a tricky part about this. in order to get to the pool, there was a street that they would have to cross. And so when they got to that street, we always told our boys to make sure, and you told your kids this too, those of you with kids, what do you tell them? Stop, look both ways, and then go. And so we would tell our boys that, and every day Tiffany would watch from the window, and they'd get to the street, they'd stop, they'd look both ways, and if there are no cars coming, then they'd go. See, I believe this idea of stop, look both ways, and then go is actually a great tool for us that this scripture describes on how we can deal with the anxiety that we may be facing. See, in the passage I read, in verse 7, it actually ends with a promise. It says this, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understandings, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." We can experience the peace that Jesus called upon that water in our own lives. If, and here's the key, if we participate. And verse 6 provides how we should participate. I think it's pretty simple. We stop, we look both ways, and then we go. Another translation reads verse 6 this way. It says, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for what he's already done." So stop. When you're facing anxiety, the first thing we need to do is stop. Stop and pray about it. The first key to combating our anxiety is to pray. Pray about everything. See, I found when it comes to my anxiety, what I like to do is I like to go, go, go. If I have anxiety about something, what I like to do is I like to try to figure out how I can solve it. And I will go and I will try to fix it and I'll make the phone calls. I will go, go, go and try to fix whatever is causing me anxiety. But here's what I've come to learn and I've come to discover, that activity actually fuels anxiety. Activity can actually fuel our anxiety if we don't take time to stop first. See, Paul challenges all of us to pray about everything. And the truth is, in order to do that, sometimes we need to stop everything else and just spend time alone with God and pray. So first step, stop. Second step is this, look both ways. Tell God what you need, the scripture says, and thank him for what he's already done. See, when we look both ways, we get to that point where we look back at the faithfulness of God in the past. And we let that inform us on how we should move forward. When we stop and we look back, we see how God has moved in our past. It reminds us about how he didn't abandon us in our darkest hours, in our deepest struggles, in all the storms we faced in our past. He brought us up out of, and he wants to do it again. Can I share with you real quickly how that looks in my life? Like many parents, I think some of my greatest anxiety comes from my children. Not from them, per se, but more like because I'm a parent, I am constantly having anxiety over my kids. Where are they? Who's driving? What are they doing? How are their grades? All these different questions. My kids cause a lot of anxiety in my life, and they don't mean to. It's just me as a dad. A couple years ago, we were asked if we would adopt another baby. At the time, my daughter was 10, and I really struggled with it. I really struggled with a lot of anxiety about whether or not we should adopt Mia. And it had nothing to do with Mia, but it had everything to do with me and myself. I kept getting anxiety in my head, things like, I don't know if I can do this 10 years later. I don't know if I can be an old dad. Old dads are no fun. Sorry, old dads. I'm one of you now. I don't know if I can handle the pressure. I don't know if we can handle it financially. I don't know if I want to change diapers again. I would just have anxiety over and over and over again in my head about this. And it was happening. We knew it was going to happen. We were ready. But I just had this anxiety. I didn't share it with anybody, not even my wife. So what I would do is I'd grab my daughter Ayla, my 10-year-old. She's not a teenager yet, so she still likes her dad. And we would go for walks. We would take the dog. She's getting closer, by the way. She's liking me less and less. But we would take our dog for a walk, and we live right next to the campus of Lake State, and we would take Mal, our big dog, and we'd take her for walks. And Ayla would just kind of run around, do her thing, and I would take my phone, and I'd snap pictures of Ayla, which really keeps her occupied. But the whole time in my head, I'd just be praying. I'd just be praying to God, going, God, I don't know if I can do this. God, I'm going to need some help here. It was really weird because in my head, I just kept getting three names back to me. I'd hear Connor, Stephen, and Ayla. And I'd pray some more, and I'd hear Connor, Stephen, and Ayla. And I'm like, God, thank you. You're reminding me that I'm already a failure with three. Let's make it four. Is that what you're trying to say, God? You know, what is happening here? And it took a few more walks before I finally realized that God was telling me, Stephen, we've done it before. I've worked before. No matter how inadequate you were as a dad with Connor, Stephen, and Ayla, we've worked through it. I've gotten you through that storm. What are you worried about this storm for? There's only one this time around. You should be, you know, the rest are getting older. You should be, have it down. And he kept reminding me over and over and over again about his faithfulness. Yeah, my inability hadn't changed. The storm was still the same. But God reminded me again and again that he's done it before and he'll do it again. So look both ways. Remember God's faithfulness and let that inform you on how to move forward. And finally this, go. Then go. See, if all my kids did was get to that street, stop, look both ways, and just waited, boy, swim practice would look pretty weird. They'd never make it. They'd just be standing there on the street corner waiting for me to come home and take them. They have to actually cross the street. And here's the thing. I think our anxiety oftentimes stops us in our tracks. Like, if we have anxiety about bill collections coming in, guess what we stop doing? Answering the phone and opening mail. Right? We just stop doing those things. All right? If we have anxiety about relationships, instead of pouring into the relationships, we just step back and are like, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what that looks like for you, but so oftentimes, anxiety, when it comes, it just stops us right where we're at. Kind of like Moses, actually. In Exodus 4, Moses had killed a man. So Moses runs away, and he gets to his father-in-law, Jethro's, and he just starts tending sheep. And he's taking care of sheep. But God has plans for Moses. God's going to use Moses to lead his people out of Egypt. So God keeps working on him. And guess what Moses does? He's making an anxiety excuses. But what if I don't talk it enough? You know, what if I'm not the good-looking guy that they need to lead him out? I don't think he used that one. But he constantly is using different excuses because of his anxiety. And finally, God reminds him, no, you're the one that I need to lead my people out. So Moses gets it, and he goes back to his father-in-law, Jethro, in verse 18, and he says this, then Moses departed, returned to Jethro, his father-in-law, and he said to him, please, let me go, that I may return to my brethren who are in Egypt and see if they are still alive. And Jethro said to Moses, go in peace. Now, the better translation of that last line there, go in peace, isn't go in peace. It's actually go to peace. See, did you catch that? Jethro knows that the way through Moses' anxiety is for him to get up and to go do what God wants for his life. To go to peace. That very same peace that Jesus talked about when he stood up and told that storm, peace, be still. The very same peace that Jesus wants for your life when the storms seem to be surrounding you, when things just don't seem to be right. Jethro's telling Moses, go to peace. Listen, if you're stuck in anxiety right now, if you got anxiety in your life, and I don't care if it's situational, I don't care if it's long-term, I don't care what kind of anxiety you're dealing with, it's time to stop. to pray about it, to take it over to God. Then it's time to look both ways. And then it's time to go. Get your feet moving. Because when we do those things, we'll shift our focus from the storm around us to the God inside of us. And when our focus shifts, great things happen for the kingdom. Would you just stand and pray with me? God, we're so thankful to have this time. This time where we can just come together here in this place and all over the place, really, God. Just to sing praises to you, to share in this meal, this communion together, to give, God, and to worship you through studying your word. And God, today we recognize that anxiety is real. And that many of us in this room are dealing with different anxiety. And God, I just want to lift people up to you today who are struggling with anxiety. Those who are struggling with fear, the what if questions. God, we lift those people over to you today. And God, we pray that they would recognize the need to stop, to look both ways, to remember what you've done and what you're going to do again, and then to go. And God, we pray that through that, their focus would become less on the storm, and more on the God who calms the storm. God, would you speak truth into our life? It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.